eat this.
I believe in miracles, and a miracle has happened tonight. My baby, it don't matter if you're black or white.
Icebreaker.
Ladies and gentlemen, can you hear me? Thank you. Thank you very much. We are indeed very honored and tired to be opening this, the 20th anniversary of Design Indaba. As you can see, our talk today is called How Purpose Drives Change in Black and White. So we kind of thought, what's a spectacular way to bring that to life? And Pepe had the bright idea that, you know, let's try something that we've never done, and that would be dancing. So it was his idea.
white guys don't have rhythm. But so it's amazing. So we're in the business of ideas, and the thing about ideas, you never actually know if it will work. So, and the one thing we do know is that it will never, ever, ever work unless you try it. So we debated this thing. I mean, it's enough pressure to actually be here and speak in front of you and then to go and do a dance on top of it. So we thought, well, let's do it. And we've done it, and now we can get into our show. But a little idea we had 17 years ago is this little one. And it happened on a couch in Johannesburg. That couch lives in my office now 17 years later. And it was this idea of starting an ad agency based on a takeaway restaurant model. So can you actually put ideas on a wall and say you can buy a rare idea, medium idea, and a well-done idea, and you charge for that? And we loved this idea so much, we actually resigned almost on the spot. So if you're from Cape Town, and you're a surfer, you might think you're at the top of the evolution chain, and right at the bottom are these guys called paddle skiers, or the Neanderthal boatmen. So we were looking for a business partner, and I was introduced to a very young guy called Gareth Leck back then. I was working for the Jupiter Drawing Room back then. And the first night I met him, we were chatting. I found out, okay, he's a really cool surfer. He told me he's a really, really cool surfer. And then in chatting, I told him, well, I'm actually a paddle skier. So, and he went like, I can't believe this, because this idiot boatman, 3 years ago, it was 1995, actually, in a big storm, there's a big storm that hits Cape Town in April, and there's a spot called Thermopylae. And apparently, this Neanderthal boatman hit the Xolisa next to the Radisson, and the guy drowned. And he was trapped under the Xolisa. And he's telling me how he actually had to go down and take this guy out. And then the NSRI came, took the guy out. And I was sitting there, I couldn't believe this, because that guy was me. So I met the guy who saved my life, unbeknown to me that there was ever human intervention. Because when it happened, I was unconscious, and I never saw a person saving my life. And based on that, we went, okay, we're going to start this business. So that's a very old shot. I was wearing bells on my toes. And we started our takeaway agency. With a menu in Loop Street, and people could walk off the street. So it was making advertising accessible to the general public. And we even had our business cards as still slips. So that's my original business card. And sassy titles, head creative chef, confusing as hell. Like, what are you doing? And he was the maitre d', the MD. And a short skip and a jump, 16 years later, we're the proud parents of a 16-year-old business, which feels like a teenager getting a bit of pimples now. So by no means do we think we've arrived. And I think the reason we are is because of partners and friends in the agency, like my partner, Xolisa.
Cool. So I think pretty much as Pepe said, our business is made up of people and it's made up of their stories. Like how I was approached, or should I say poached, by Pepe and Gareth back in 2006. He still had long hair then and bells on his shoes. And they asked me to come and join them in Johannesburg, and I was based in Cape Town at the time. Or how a Frenchman who speaks five languages, his name is Laurent, but we prefer to call him Larry, it's easier. So how a Frenchman who was a client for 10 years decided to come and join us as our head of strategy. And it's through people like Laurent and Pepe that, and also a lot of people that are back in the agency, which we'll be speaking about quite a lot today, that we've been able to turn that little diner into what we today call Joe Public United, which is essentially a collection of specialist companies that, you know, give you the whole through-the-line offering. Not only that, we've been able to grow beyond our borders. We now also have a Joe Public that we're very proud of in Amsterdam. That is Antoine, who is one of the founding partners of Joe Public Amsterdam. They still use the menu option, or the menu business model, and they're actually doing very well. Within their first 3 years, they are rated in the top three advertising agencies in Amsterdam, so we're really proud of them. But also, what we're very proud of right here at home is that as late as November last year, Joe Public moved into the Joe Public United building in Johannesburg, which is really just an amazing space where we try and inspire our people to really find their greatness. If you just click on Pepe, these are just some more shots of the studio and our guys pretending to work very hard, acting like there's no camera in their faces. There's even a client over there. There's one of our Nedbank clients. I don't know how he got through the security. But the one thing that we do try and do for all our staff is that we do encourage everybody to be uncomfortable, because we do believe that if you're uncomfortable and you're stretching yourself, then it's probably a good thing, because it means that you're growing.
So the purpose of the presentation is just to share with you guys an idea we're deeply passionate about, which is having purpose in your business. So our little journey to that, finding our purpose, is just a quick little overview, because we started very small in Cape Town. And then sort of year on year had growth. And what happened is in 2001, we sold our business model 100% in that international group. And the idea was to take this model overseas. So it wasn't money involved. It's more about, wow, we can have an agency in New York. And my mom will be so proud. And we were like, let's do this thing. And then what happened in 2001, just as we opened our doors in New York City, 9/11 happened. And there was an economic crash. And that little agency closed down. And our third partner to this day is in the States. And Gareth and myself were stuck in South Africa with our passion. And then in 2004, we were merged with a Johannesburg struggling concern. So we grew our business then through a merger to about 68 people. And it was very, very tough to suddenly take a culture of excellence and a culture of ideas into a culture of just making money and churn and trying to get to grips with it. And incidentally, in that period, we had absolutely no growth. And what happened was one of the senior execs was the owner of the previous business. We had a bit of a fallout with him, and we retrenched him, and he went to work for our biggest client, and 3 months later fired us. So probably, which meant that. And that was like sort of the like a dark day in a stock exchange. When you lose half your business, you have to retrench 35 people overnight. And it's fundamental, because the worst thing that can happen is often the best thing that can happen, because we realized an opportunity to buy our business back. We never knew it was going to take all but 3 years of fighting with the holding agents or company in America to get our business back. But in 2009, on the 27th of February, we bought our business back, 100% South African owned. And it's amazing, because it was in the middle of the worst recession ever, that we had to borrow desks and borrow machines. And here we're all starting with our 30 staff and a handful of treasured clients, rebuilding this business from absolute scratch. And it seems like when life is really at a low, when you're getting it thrown at you, that you really dig deep. And we started asking the question, why are we in business? Like, yes, we make ads, we know what we do, but why do we do this thing that we do? And there's been a lot of talk since 2009 around this issue of purpose in a business. And this is a very interesting little insight, very quickly, is that we've got conscious and the unconscious mind. What's fascinating is the conscious mind processes at 2,000 bits per second, but the unconscious mind processes at 400 billion bits per second. So unconsciously, there's drivers in us as humans, and there's drivers in us subconsciously as business we're not even aware of. And we really did a lot of work over a period of about 6 months to find out what's at the heart of this business. And we, through this process with our staff at that stage, we found there's a far greater purpose to our business than just advertising. And we call it our mighty why. This is why we come to work every single day. And it's simply one word called growth. Now, that sounds really, really simple. We've been running these processes with other small businesses. There's always a different word subconsciously at the heart of a business. And what it means to us is often, especially in our game, the advertising game, we're quite self-serving. We win awards. It's all about ego, about us. And we change that way of being to embrace more selfless way of serving. So every day we go to work, we serve the growth of our clients. And we authentically serve it. We don't just say it because we know NetBank sitting here and some other clients are sitting here. We authentically serve their growth. We serve the growth of our people. And ultimately, we serve the growth of our country. And not just any growth. We call our growth, growth to the power of N. And it's exponential growth. So in any situation, on any brief, on any internal sort of challenge to one of our people, or even the challenges we face in the community we serve, we look at how can we actually add exponential value to what we do. We don't always deliver it, but we really strive to do this every day. So what happened is we planted this in this core of our business as a belief system, and lo and behold, the next year we grew 37%, the next year we grew 78%, the next year 63% year-on-year growth, and then last year 25% year-on-year, which is just spectacular, because if you look at the tradition, like the almost average growth curve until that point of changing our behavior, it was just a spectacular turnaround in our business. And we call this beat the line.
Cool. So as Pepe was saying, this is an approach that we take through everything as far as the business goes. So we just want to take you through three different areas, which is growth of our clients, which is growth of our people, and then ultimately at the end, we'll take you through growth of our country. And the first piece of work that we'd like to share with you this morning is something that we did for Tracker. And the question that we had to answer in 2010 for Tracker was, how do you get people to purchase a tracker when their cars are already insured? So what we found is that a lot of people saw a tracking device on their car as a secondary form of insurance. And a lot of them actually felt that if my car is hijacked, I actually don't want to get it back. But what was very, very interesting is that in the stories that we were getting from the brand itself is that often when they actually recover a car, there is a baby in the back seat, or there is an animal in the car, or even worse, often there is a person that is locked in the boot. So the growth insight that we came up with for Tracker was the fact that Tracker recovers more than just cars. They recover, as a proven fact, in many instances, lives. And the piece that we created, which we were about to show, was part of an integrated campaign which actually saw their sales double from about 300,000 to 750,000 over a period of 4 years.
All of these lands across my face tell you the story of who I am. So many stories of where I've been, and now I got to where I am. It's true, I was made for you. I climbed across mountain tops, swam all across the ocean blue, across over land and out of local rules, and maybe I broke them all for you. Oh, because even when I was flat broke, you made me feel like a million bucks. You
Thank you. The next piece that we'd like to share with you today was a piece that we did for our client Nike. And the question that we had to answer in this instance is, how do we win a global pitch against seven nations? And basically what it is that, you know, Nike does races all over the world. And they have a pool of budget that they have annually for their emerging markets. And they look for the idea, the most compelling idea that can turn their race into something a bit bigger. And so what we did is that we looked for some kind of an insight that would be unique to South Africa and that would make this more than just a normal Nike race. And the growth insight that we found, which ultimately saw us win the global pitch and get to run this race in our country, and this is probably a lot for the foreign people in the audience today, but the insight was the fact that in a country that fought for freedom, we are not free to run where we want. So especially if you look at a place like Johannesburg, because of high levels of crime, the places that people actually go and run are places like treadmills, gyms, inside the complexes, but people are not really free to run in the places that they want. And using this insight, we created a piece of work. And I think it's very, very important for me to mention that this was by no means just a Joe Public piece, but credit must go to Nike, our client, to their digital agency at the time, which was Trigger Isobar, and to also VWV, which was the event agency. And this was the piece of work.
Run your city. Run where they say you can't. Run off campus. Run commissioner. Run captain. Run where no one dares. Run in the blackness of night. Run with your breath in your ears. Run like you have nothing to lose. Run triumphant. Run to make history. Run for your right to run.
The next piece that we'd like to show is one that was done for our client who's here today, Nedbank. And the first piece that we wanted to show for Nedbank is really just a demonstration of the bank's intention, which is to make South Africans more financially fit with their money or savvy with their money. And it was really just an activation that was motivating people to save for a rainy day. And the next piece that I'd like to share with you today is one that we are very, very excited about. You are the first people to get to know about it. And it's to launch the Make Ideas for Change Happen, which is Nedbank is celebrating the fact that they are partnering with Design Indaba for the very first time. And what it is the Nedbank Ideas ATM. Some of you may have seen it as you walked in. And basically how this Ideas ATM works is that instead of withdrawing money from it, we are actually asking you, this esteemed creative community with all your bright minds, to actually deposit your ideas into the Nedbank Ideas ATM. And we want to use those ideas to solve a social problem and to ultimately make change. So you will have seen in your delegate bags when you collected and when you registered downstairs, you are given an ideas checkbook. So we're asking you every day to write down an idea to the social problem which will be told to you and you'll be reminded of, and it's also in the envelope, but we're asking you to write down whatever your idea is, put it in the envelope and deposit it into the ideas ATM. At the end of every day, our judging panel, which includes quite a few of the speakers at Design Indaba this year, will judge the winning idea. The winning idea every day will win a brand new iPad, courtesy of Nedbank, thank you very much. And then on the very last day, which is on Friday, we will take the three winning ideas and the ultimate winner will be selected. And that person will go on to win the grand prize, which is a trip to South by Southwest in Austin, Texas next year. But more importantly, and what we are most excited about, is the fact that Nedbank has actually committed that that winning idea to solve that social problem, they will make that idea for change happen before Design Indaba 2016. So a round of applause to Nedbank for that. It's your turn.
So just the last two pieces of work we're going to share. This one's for a client that approached us in 2009. It's actually unbelievable because we were literally about 2 weeks away from running out of business. We were running out of cash and we found this client, and it was a pitch for USAID and Johns Hopkins. And the brief was, how can we create change within the behavior of men 30 and plus in South Africa within the context of HIV/AIDS? And I actually remember exactly the office on the Sunday with Xolisa and his art director then working on this when they actually cracked this movement, Brothers for Life. So we've been working on it for the past 6 years. Brothers for Life is probably the biggest movement for men in South Africa today. And we chose to show this, just this one piece. It's probably the smallest piece in terms of money, but it's the biggest idea. It's just an amazing idea, and it shows the simplicity of an idea and how it can actually create impact without costing a cent.
I'm not going to be able to do it. Kusasa ilanga lizokukhanyisela
indlela eya ekhaya ungene emasangweni uthingo lwenkosazana endaweni enye yakho isalinuka
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 kusase umfula
Usase umfula,
Isalinuka,
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 Usase umfula,
Usase umfula,
Usase umfula.
Ayikho indlela eyakhaya masisha,
umfula impilo. Anuka iele
Impilo umfula
Umpilo kinuka
Umfula namandla
Nuka imadla
Umfula maukeleze
Lega imiditswe ke letsatsi Iela lile khanata
Isalinuka
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 Uma ukhulelwe imvula ugeleze mazinyembezi
And then lastly, fascinating story. So dial direct, client absolutely bleeding, losing customers. We've been doing retail for years for them. CEO came into us, challenged us, you got to fix this for us. And we revert back to what we believe in, which is human connection. And we search for insight within this brand. And the thing is, when you actually have a car accident, you don't really worry about your car when you're insured. You worry much more about the time you're going to waste now fixing this. And we realized through experience that we worked with the brand for the past 6 years, and they really are quite obsessed about saving their customers' time. We put the two together, and a big idea came out of it that dial direct ensures your most precious thing, your time. And this commercial launched in January. There's a whole lot of work following it soon, and already in the first month, they doubled their sales based on this very insightful piece of work.
Shivers offshore through the tides of oceans. We are shining in the rising sun. As we are floating in the blue, I am softly watching you. Oh boy, your eyes betray what burns inside you. Whatever I feel for you, you only seem to care about you. Is there any chance you could see me too? 'Cause I love you. Is there anything I could do just to get some attention from you? In the ways I've lost every trace of you. Where are you?
Noah? Where have you been?
I've been saving you time so you can come to my place.
Whatever I feel for you, you only seem to care about you. Is there any chance you could see me too?
We know how precious every minute is.
Is there
so we won't waste any of yours.
So very quickly, we're going to speed up a little bit. We're running behind, but we really believe all people are born creative, all people, not just people labeled creative people. So within our organization, we just believe creativity is the ability to think, and we've created tools to unlock thinking within Joe Public. We call our main driver Joe Grow Tool. And for many years, there was actually resistance against it because we used to measure people out of 100%. And we started thinking, it seems like measuring shut people down. And when you think about it, we spend 12 years of our life in a system called education that measures you. So you start questioning, does education actually dumb creativity down? And what we've done is a very simple thing with our tool, and we did it 2 years ago, and we can see real change, is inverse the tool. So instead of measuring out of 100, we now, people are aiming to score 0 every year. And what that means is where in the old system you'd score 60% of your growth goals per annum, you now have a 40% room for growth. And it's really changed the way people operate within our business.
Cool. And I just think we've got such an amazing pot of the most different individuals, right from our juniors to some of our senior staff, the guys that do our fashion, people like Rowena, who's directing a lot of what you see around here today, Tina, who's being mentored by Hanley, all kinds and all different types. But I think the one thing for us is really just the fact that there are many, many people behind this Joe Public engine. And I think that in the true spirit of Ubuntu, we would not be standing here if it wasn't for them.
So lastly, huge driver for us, growth of our country. And the question we ask is, there's so many learnings in a small organization when you're really intent on growing of people that you start thinking, can we apply this approach to education in our country? Or can an agency change a country? An ad agency, which sounds quite obscure. Or can we create an educational system that's potentially a shining example to the world, because globally there's pressure on education? And it's quite a big question if you think there's 27,000 schools in South Africa, of which 22,000 are dysfunctional, and that's a fact. And we say an idea will never, ever, 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 like Winston Churchill said, will never, ever work unless you try it. So we're just trying it. And as they say in Africa, when you have to eat an elephant, do so one bite at a time. I'm a vegan. It's a bit of a weird quote. So we started one school at a time in 2008. And one of the most amazing things was sitting about 18 months ago looking at the statistics in the school after doing various projects ongoingly and realizing that English is taught as a second language. And if you were ever taught the language as a second language, it means almost zero comprehension. But maths and science are taught in English.
Yeah, and I think it's quite a contentious subject. I mean, we both, or as an agency, believe in first language tuition. I think that's the best thing. But there's a reality that our students are sitting with right now, and that is the fact that these two very difficult subjects are actually taught in a language that they don't understand. So the question that we asked ourselves is, could we help them by helping them comprehend English a bit better? And this was the piece that we created for them.
South Africa, the Rainbow Nation, has 11 official languages. Constitutionally, each is equal. Yet English is only spoken by less than 10% of the population, but is taught as a second language at 80% of our schools, which means most learners are not competent in this language. So imagine their understanding of maths and science, which are taught in English. And how will they cope at a tertiary level? Because 16 of our 21 universities teach in English. Could the 50% university dropout rate have something to do with this language barrier? Could the solution be teaching all learners English as a first language? One school at a time, a registered NGO wanted to test what difference 1 week's English tutoring could make. So we decided to perform an experiment on national radio. To kick it off, we started the language debate in the media.
Showing there's a difference if you start learning in first language, your other subjects also improve.
Then it was time to perform the experiment. We took one learner, one tutor, 1 week. Each morning she was recorded reading a radio spot and then spent the afternoon with her tutor. On Monday, Lesego was off to a slow start.
Hello, I'm Lesego. I'm in grade 8 at Itirele Zenzele High School in Deep Slot.
On Tuesday, Wednesday and Thursday, we heard a daily improvement.
Hello, it is Lesego again. With 1 week of extra English classes, my English can get better. I am part of an experiment with one school at a time. In 5 days can make a difference. Imagine what 5 years could do.
By Friday, Lesego's reading had improved from 108 words a minute to 152 words a minute. Her comprehension and confidence also improved dramatically.
I think I sound much better now. 1 week of English classes has helped me. And I think all Nenas should also get help, if English is not their first language either.
Using these findings, one school at a time is raising money to employ a full-time first language English teacher at Fort Hare High School. Because if this is what 5 days of tuition can do, imagine what 5 years could do.
So we're just going to wrap up. We're over time. We do many, many things within these schools. It's a real passion of our agency. We do fundraising to raise enough capital. We've got amazing clients contributing. It's actually becoming quite a substantial project. But what we want to share just in two things in closing. We've built like stuff. I mean, it's incredible. In a country so challenged, you actually find a lot of meaning in what you do. But in essence, the biggest thing is the results we're starting to see in the school. And over the past 6 years, since 2008, there's been a huge shift in the outcome of the school in terms of pass rate, but specifically in quality pass rate, which has gone up from 18% to over 50%, which catapulted the school from in the 600s in terms of quality performing school to number 3 in Gauteng, which is spectacular. We're very proud of it. And then very much lastly, we've got a Funds for the Future project that was designed by our company, Joe Public Shift, which is launching in the exhibition area. There's a stand there where they took 200 kids' handwriting and turned it into fonts, and you can purchase the fonts and actually contribute to the kids' education of their dreams. So it's Funds for the Future, and we're giving 300 fonts away. So if you go to the fundsforthefuture.com/share, first 300 people that help sharing the initiative will get a free font of one of those kids. So in conclusion, on behalf of myself and Xolisa, we believe that our world is in need of change. It does not be all negative. We are having a lot of fun doing what we do. And we really believe creativity drives change, but nothing drives creativity more than having a purpose within what you do. Thank you.